Welcome back, everyone, to theCUBE's live coverage here at Supercomputing 2025. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE with Jackie McGuire with theCUBE Research. Andy Pernsteiner is here, field CTO of Vast Data. Welcome back to theCUBE. You were on our original SuperCloud 4, I think, or 3, and then at the NYSC. Great to see you again.
Great to see you as well. Thanks for having me.
The show for Vast, your booth's huge. A lot of activity around the company. $1 billion software deal, very high number. You don't see those very often. I can't remember.
I don't know of any Jeff Denmore was saying about that.
How's the show going for you? You're out in front of customers, so you're out doing the deals, because these aren't like, hey, you want to buy a watch. These are like serious system deals. Take us through what the show's been like for you first.
Well, so from a show standpoint, a lot of what I've been focusing on is meeting with customers and kind of reminding them about all of the things that we do. You know, the thing is we meet with a lot of existing customers here at Supercompute as well as prospective ones, and the existing ones, it's always good to hear what their experience is with the product and also what their ideas are for how to use the newest set of features that we've been releasing. And for me, this is what I get out of it. I try and test out ideas, I see what ideas they have, and then we can use them at scale. And so you mentioned the $1 billion order, those don't happen overnight.
Not for software.
And the other part of it is that it takes a lot of people on our side to come up with everything that we need to. There's so many logistics and pieces associated with it, but it's really validation that all the work that we've been doing is providing real value to people.
We've been following you guys since the beginning, the launch in our studio and watching the success. Renan's been on multiple times, so we've been kind of documenting the rise of the Vastronauts, as you're called. But what's interesting is the deals that are announced here with Azure, it's the software stack that's kind of evolving. Take us through where that software stack is now, where it came from and where it is pushing the envelope on, where are the wins coming from and why?
Yeah. I mean, if you think about back in time, the HPC community was our focus, primarily the research labs and a lot of the sort of publicly funded research institutions. And our focus initially was providing a cost-effective all-flash storage platform for doing large-scale analytics and data processing. And you know, that's interesting enough.
Yeah, that's good.
But we wanted to solve bigger problems. We extended the platform to support enterprise-grade encryption, data protection services, all of the things that people would expect from what you would consider to be a more traditional enterprise file system, we brought to large-scale all-flash implementations. And so our ability to sort of morph into a company that could not only service the needs of HPC, but also the needs of the enterprise, really sort of kept bringing us forward in terms of the new ideas that we had, the features and functionalities we added. And over the last several years, as you've probably noticed, there's been the dawn of the NeoClouds or the GPU as a service clouds. And we found very similar workloads in those worlds as we did in the HPC worlds, but now the sort of level of I would say the level at which they operate, because GPUs are so much more expensive, they require so much more power, it's much more important to get things right in those environments. I'm not saying it's not important to do it right in the classic HPC world, but
just a lot of sunk costs.
I mean, when you're spending billions of dollars just on GPUs, you need to make sure that when they're running, they don't have a hiccup. And so a lot of the largest customer successes that we've had, including the most recent deal with CoreWeave, is based on the fact that our platform can scale, but then also is highly resilient, so that they can get the most out of all of their investments, not just out of storage.
Well, they can quantify. They can quantify a hiccup.
Yeah.
Define hiccup.
In millions of dollars
Define
per
hiccup.
Minute.
What's a flub? What's a hiccup?
Yeah.
Take me through what a hiccup is.
And as we've, well, a hiccup obviously.
No, I mean, what kind of error, where things break down, you got do it yourself.
Oh, yeah.
You guys got the platform. When I say hiccup, things that could go wrong.
So I know what can go wrong. I am a data scientist. I come from a data science background, but I went to a boot camp. So I learned how to write Python over 6 months.
Yeah.
I never really learned how to do things like data at scale.
Yeah.
I learned you open a Jupyter notebook, you import everything you could possibly think you could ever
want. It works great on your laptop.
You hard code all your API keys.
Why not?
So when I was reading the blog you wrote on the Vast Data Engine, that one of the things that can go wrong is your data scientists don't necessarily understand infrastructure.
Yeah.
And one of the things that you highlighted in your blog was kind of the ability to use simple Python to do things you need to do.
Yeah.
And I was like, yes!
Basic things.
I did so many bad things that I didn't mean to do because because I didn't have a background that would have enabled me to understand the risks I was taking, like running up
and to
five
be
or
honest,
six figure cloud computing bills because I didn't limit
you
the number of
S3
things.
Left bucket
I was,
open.
I didn't limit the number of things I was pulling from Kibana. Put a query in, went
right,
to
so
lunch,
what was the
came back.
What would be a NeoCloud example of? Because they're on a tight rope. They're spending dough. They got to earn cash. What are some of the things that you guys solve for them versus alternatives that they would use?
I mean, to start with, the platform is resilient. We started in HPC because we knew they'd beat the crap out of us, and we made sure to be resilient in the face of that.
Yeah, yeah.
We also came in from the world of having enterprise backgrounds where downtime wasn't an option. Upgrades had to be non-disruptive. So let's just start with the basics right there. But in terms of the NeoClouds, we're increasingly seeing them want to offer more services to their end users. I mean, renting GPUs by the hour is one thing, but providing service layers on top of it, I mean, if you think about, let's say, CoreWeave, do they want to have to build their own block store, their own database table format? Do they want to have to create their own mechanisms for doing all these things? Or would they rather take something that exists and is on the same platform what they're using for everything else and expose it? And so we can increase the ability for them to, or reduce the time to market, you could say, for them to offer these higher level services to their users. It just means that they can get the most out of their investment.
And I think what I like about, I said earlier, following you guys, the software stack, you took your lumps in HPC, that's kind of like spring training. If you get through that, you can win anything, right?
I think so.
You know, and so you go to the NeoClouds, they need to have a software stack, so they plug you in. Okay, next question is enterprise. I won't say the laggards, but they are kind of the laggards because the pressure on the NeoClouds because of the demand curve.
Yeah.
We're expecting to see the enterprises rolling. So, okay, what's the solution there? It's not as clean to swap out fabric.
I think one of the challenges in the enterprise, besides that they have a lot more process to follow. They have policies, there's regulation, especially in the financial services world, that prevents them from just moving too quickly. We find that oftentimes, and this is something common I see in the large banks, that they can start a pilot to create an AI factory, for example. But they can't bring it to production at scale because they don't have a platform that gives them all of the resiliency and the security and the traceability and data governance that's required. And so it stays in a sandbox forever.
Yeah.
And so our goal is to help people understand how to leverage things like the data engine, including all of the policy controls that we have, to make it so that you can take something from your laptop, deploy it at scale, but in a way that aligns to corporate policy or aligns to data governance policies. Like that
provides resiliency, provides
all of
multi-region.
That.
Yeah.
What's that blocker? How do you release, how do you break through that blocker? It's like we need a TSA clear pre version of these projects because there's this huge sprawl of sandbox backlog that's kind of stuck there. Some call it POC purgatory, but is it skill set, bandwidth, lack of standards? Why is the blockage?
Right?
Maturity?
Honestly, where I see things getting broken down is, as you mentioned earlier, as a developer, you learned how to write code and how to how to analyze data and process data. You didn't know about infrastructure or scale. A lot of the infrastructure people don't understand the problems you're trying to solve.
Right.
So our goal is to bridge the gap between those two groups of people and be a layer where we can offer services for developers to do things at scale, but we do so in a way that allows the infrastructure people to manage it very easily. Because that ends up being a breakdown where people might sandbox something, but then they have to go and deploy it somewhere, and there is no infrastructure team that knows how to deploy these things at scale.
Yeah, and you can't just hire three people because it's going to take months for them to get up to speed on what you've done, what you need to do. You can't just hire somebody and on Monday they're in your cloud doing deployment at scale.
It's very challenging. And the other part of it is that I look at a lot of the sandbox projects and they're going and iterating on which vector database do I use, which models do I choose. And we're not necessarily going to be opinionated on everything, but we've built most of the functionality into the platform so they don't have to go and POC every random vector store. They don't have to POC every single Kubernetes control plane. Like, if we offer these and they don't have to do anything besides just enable a feature on the platform, it speeds up their time to development and deployment and it just makes it easier for them to manage. Because nobody really wants to go manage a separate Kafka cluster to manage Knative services on their own. They don't want to manage all these pieces. It'd be much easier if it was integrated into a platform, and that's where we're really focused on
energy. Or to go through the RFP process and manage like five different SOWs, and like that's...
Everything
sometimes
takes
even
time.
Just the
All right,
the
so, the so the silos, or you guys are breaking that down, the software stack moves around. What I'm intrigued is that you're now moving to different environments, super cloud, multi-cloud, whatever you want to call it, but that's not just cloud. That's like you're going to have behind the meter on some edge cases. You're going to have now, the software stack's going to be distributed.
Yeah.
So what part of the value proposition in AI is horizontal scale and having data access across environments with models doing their job wherever they need to go.
Yes.
That requires a connected intelligence. How do you look at that? What are you seeing any use cases around that kind of deployment?
We do. I mean, we can even focus, you know, even taking AI out of the frame of reference for a moment, even in general purpose existing workloads, having the ability to compute where the data is mm-hmm. and having the data able to be accessed wherever the compute needs it to be is a challenge that everybody has to deal with even outside of AI. AI obviously amplifies that. Yeah. And so our goal is to, again, make a simple layer that makes it easy for data to be where it needs to be. And I'm not going to pretend like we defeat speed of light, right? We can hide it a little bit, but we can also create mechanisms for people to easily move the data where it needs to go without having to make extra copies, without having to manage large dependencies. Like, we can make things much simpler. And, you know, it's like anything else. If you don't make it simple, people aren't going to do it.
Yeah, with the data engine, I was at Cribble for a while, right? And so what you find is that I'm the security guru here, and the whole processing the data where it is, where it needs to be, people pay based on ingest for a lot of platforms, right? So the more you can do where the data is to shape it into what you need to do, to ingest it in the right format, to process it in the right way, and then send only what needs to go to a platform only, like only that data there, that actually must be a huge efficiency gain, but also financial gain.
Ultimately, everything ends up coming down to cost.
Yeah.
Doesn't it? People talk about the word performance. Performance is another word for cost, right?
Yeah.
And you mentioned the ingestion. Like there are a lot of platforms out there that charge based on ingestion rates, that charge based on CPU hours used. And if we can reduce those down, either by advances in our database or advances in using our data engine to do pre-processing in situ, it does reduce the amount they have to push somewhere else. It reduces their egress fees into and out of the cloud. Like there's all kinds of side benefits that you get from it.
Andy, talk about the realities on multi-vendor. Not every company is going to want to roll out VAST 100%. You guys are coming in with a great platform for all the benefits you talked about. How do you guys look at other data sets? Talk about how your strategy was to kind of, I won't say encapsulate, bad word, but like how
we... at first we just told everybody to move everything to us, just do it. but they didn't just do it.
Well, you got a billion dollar order.
It's
working at many levels. But you do have a reality where you have some legacy.
Yes.
Enterprise specifically, sometimes brittle, but no one wants to play with it. Do you guys look at abstracting that into the platform? What's the rollout look like?
There's multiple facets here, but the one that we've been focusing on lately is we have clients that are going to have data in multiple data centers on multiple storage mediums. And sometimes it's not going to be on VAST. And so we developed another software product that we are actually giving away for free, at least right now, to all of our customers that allows them to not only migrate data from place to place, but also to index everything where it is. And so they can build a holistic picture of all of their data, identify, okay, some of this data looks like it could move over to VAST for the most efficient way of processing it, and some of it maybe it needs to sit in Deep Glacier or wherever it happens to be. We're not picky. So it's called Sync Engine, and it has the ability to index and migrate data both from POSIX-related file systems as well as object stores. We've also built connectors for Confluence, Google Drive, and we're working on OneDrive now, because we also find that as people build data engine pipelines to do document classification or RAG or any sort of derivatives, they need a way to bring the data in. You can't just magically do it. It has to go through a pipeline, and to bring that data in at scale reliably is challenging. And so there's another blog post I'm about to launch, which focuses on that aspect of it, moving large quantities of data from different disparate sources and bringing them through the platform and through a data engine pipeline.
So it's a nice way to give some inventory views of where you got your data, let the customer decide, let that sleeping dog lie right there, we'll come to it later, or I don't really need to have real time or whatever AI onto it.
Definitely, and we have customers who are moving massive amounts of data using this, 50 petabytes at a time. Yeah. And there's customers using it to move small amounts of data. We're not so picky. We try to design everything with scale in mind, and so it can start small and get very large, and that's just a principle that we've always had.
All right, what's the best meeting you've had here at the show that you could share? You don't have to name the name, but like categorically lay out
the... Pick favorites.
So there was one, and you're going to figure out who it is in a minute, but they're working on building out a sort of publicly funded AI factory. And the idea is that they can offer GPU compute and storage as a service for very scientific related purposes. At the end of the meeting, we all clapped because, well, it means that we all get to go to Italy to help build this with them.
I think we interviewed that company on theCUBE here.
Yeah.
But that's the scope of the scale. If I guess my final question would be, how has the scope of the scale changed just from 3 years ago?
Oh my gosh.
I mean, you guys launched.
It's so hard to even remember three years ago.
I mean, what year is it?
From a storage standpoint, you can fit 5 petabytes in 2 rack units without any kind of compression or anything, right? We see customers who can fit 10 petabytes in 2 rack units. Like, when I worked, I had previous jobs at other companies, 10 petabytes wasn't even a thought for a gigantic system, right? And so 3 years ago, I feel like the scale of our systems, we were definitely on the trajectory where we were headed in this direction, but now for a system that's 100 or 200 or 400 petabytes, it's kind of just noise.
Yeah.
It used like to be that was the thing that all was focused on.
Yeah.
Now it's just they happen almost every week.
There's more data coming. Everyone's more data is coming in.
Everybody wants more of it, and they want to process all of it. So it's very interesting.
Annie, thank you so much for spending the time. I know you're super busy at the show.
It's for coming on. Very much a pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks for coming on. I'm John Furrier with Jackie McGuire. Breaking it down, the data's coming, the systems are getting bigger, and in all ways, more dense, and the power in this AI generation. Thanks for watching.